Hey, Coulson, what's up?
It's an honor to meet you, officially.
So, what have you been up to?
I watched you while you were sleeping.
Hey there, welcome back, everybody. Thank you for tuning in to another episode of Basically Explained. Today, we have a special episode. Special because today we are reformatting the entirety of the series. So before Basically Explained used to be kind of this really small short, like less than 5 minutes, where I would just kind of explain what happens in a comic and just throw in a few jokes and a few gifs and stuff like that. I've decided that I don't want to do that same format anymore, just because of the fact that it's doesn't really offer too much of anything to the discussion about comics and things like that on the internet. So I decided to reformat where I'm going to be talking more about themes and ideas and how comics and fandom can affect you as a person and how it can help inspire you. Without further ado, today's episode is going to be about the comic S.H.I.E.L.D. from 2014. First, let me just kind of say my thoughts on the TV show Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I like the show. I think it's decent. I think it had a little bit of a rocky start, but I think it kind of found its footing. But nothing super special. Okay. Freaking hate ties. I think that the comic S.H.I.E.L.D., written by Mark Waid, is far superior to the TV show for a few different reasons. But to explain those reasons, let's get into the story and start seeing what exactly happens. So, first of all, we start off with our boy Coulson, who is living proof that something good has actually come out of Ohio. Coulson is this nerd. He loves reading about superheroes. He knows their origin stories, he knows when they first appeared, he knows their power set. And we see that this skill is built as the years go on. You know, he's in college, he's watching the news, he becomes an analyst at S.H.I.E.L.D., he becomes a field agent, and even when he's being tortured, the thing that keeps him going is his love for superheroes. He is the ultimate nerd. His superpower, his strength, is knowing these characters. And in many ways, that validates who we are as comic book nerds. This comic book storyline starts off with creatures from the Nine Realms just popping up all over Earth. The big hitters are all preoccupied, so Coulson and his team are left to deal with a crisis in the Middle East. There is a terrorist that has captured a city using this magical sword. So they go over there to investigate, they get attacked by the guy, and they find out that Heimdall, not Idris Elba, Heimdall's been captured by this terrorist, and he's using Heimdall's sword to wreak havoc. Coulson, of course, being the ultimate nerd, has come prepared. He brought the two greatest swordsmen in the Marvel Universe, that is Valkyrie and the Black Knight. They fight against the guy, they take the sword, they bring it back to Heimdall, but plot twist, Heimdall is actually possessed by this weird black crystal. They manage to free Heimdall from the influence of the crystal, but basically it opens up the storyline to a greater conspiracy of something going on. Now this brings me to the first thing that I'd like to compare the show and the comic on. You've got budgetary constraints. You can only CGI so much stuff, and obviously paying for animation and CGI, that costs money. Whereas in a comic book, you don't have those same types of constraints. You can show big battles. You're only limited by the imagination of the writer and the author. Now, the rest of the issues kind of have standalone stories. For example, issue 2 takes place in a high school where Miss Marvel attends, and apparently there are kids that are stealing technology from defeated supervillains and then selling them to their fellow classmates like it's the drug market. It's a uniquely Marvel Universe problem. Well, you get to see Miss Marvel in action here, and she gets to out-nerd our intrepid hero, Phil Coulson. This, again, is highlighting something that limits the show. The show is limited by continuity. The show is limited by what characters they can use, how many actors they can pay. You don't have to pay for an actor to have Spider-Man in a comic for a one-off issue. I just think that it's something that adds uniqueness to the comic book format. You can have as much imagination and as much creativity as you want in a comic book. What looks like a rave going on at Doctor Strange's house. Coulson is there on the job, brings along Spider-Man with him, and he also brings along famed Russian wizard. They have to fight their way through some Cthulhus. You can tell that bad things are happening because this guy outside is turning into evil Grimace. So we see that Coulson is also affected by this evil spell that's going on, but just as things look hopeless and Coulson looks like he's gonna attack the other heroes, he ends up just knocking the book out of the guy's hand and nothing ends up happening. Sometimes you don't need super strength like Spider-Man. You don't need a spider sense. Sometimes you just need a regular guy that can just knock something out of a dude's hand. Fourth issue, not much happens here. We find out that Invisible Woman is actually an agent of S.H.I.E.L.D. She's working with Coulson on this op. And also, I don't know how Wonder Woman got stuck with the invisible jet when Sue Storm should be the one that has the invisible jet. Anyway, the fourth issue, we find out that this Duck Dynasty guy is going around shooting the Marvel Universe's top sorcerers and magic users. Yeah, then Scarlet Witch shows up to try to see what's going on. The problem, as usual, is trolls.
Bowed!
Yeah, trolls are forging a bunch of weapons, including this gun that is firing bullets that's made out of the same crystal that we saw at the beginning of the story. Agent May lays down the law, and they find out that an outside force has hired them to create these bullets and to specifically hand them to people who would target the Marvel Universe's magic users. Now, the issue ends on a major cliffhanger with Fitz shooting Scarlet Witch and reveals that he's actually Cyclops. Well, he's not actually Cyclops. Basically, what's going on is he's affected by something called the Mindless Plague, and he's been controlled by an outside force, that outside force being Dormammu. The next issue starts off with this Mindless Plague is spreading all over the world. It's affecting all the smartest minds first, so that includes Fitz and Simmons. Coulson feels like he has at least a little bit of time before it starts affecting him and the others. They have to find a way to get to Dormammu and stop him in his tracks. There is one analyst who has been transcribing a bunch of magical spells into the S.H.I.E.L.D. computers. As a result, let's just say he's got a few problems going on for him right now. Creates a magical pentagram made of computers and wires and using digitized spells to open a portal to Dormammu's lair. While they're gone, they have the monster squad here defend the portal. Coulson decides to shoot Dormammu with a bullet made out of the same black crystal, seemingly the only thing that can hurt him. But naturally, Discount Ghost Rider over here is able to block the bullet before he's able to actually do any harm.
Evidently they eat lead.
Coulson, though, always has a trick up his sleeve, and this again brings us to the theme that Coulson's nerdiness and understanding of superheroes and supervillains in the universe helps save the day. So he brings in the Absorbing Man. Absorbing Man is able to take on the properties of any material that he touches, so naturally he touches the black stone material that is able to hurt Dormammu. The world is saved. And then the Howling Commandos over here just kind of stay behind and beat up Takeoff for a little bit. In conclusion, comic books have fewer constraints than TV shows do. They are able to think bigger, they're able to act bigger, they're able to show bigger. That doesn't always help, of course, and sometimes you can get amazing superhero TV shows. I'm not trying to discount those. But what I am trying to say is that comic books are their own unique format, and you can't just substitute a TV show for a comic book. Comic books lend themselves to bigger imagination, which is what we see personified in Phil Coulson. Phil Coulson is the ultimate nerd. He validates our collective desire to know more lore about these fictional universes. Because at the end of the day, it's Phil Coulson's optimism that he has gleaned from learning about these heroes, and then also his knowledge that ends up saving the day. And not only that, but it also shows that you don't need to be Iron Man, you don't need to be Thor, you don't need to be Spider-Man to save the day. Sometimes what the world needs is Phil Coulson.